4 out of the top 5 richest people in India belong to Gujarat, a state on the western borders of the country. In the 1970s, a small ethnic group from India named the Patels from the same state of Gujarat first began arriving in the United States as poorly educated people with no money to their name. Today, the small subpart of Indians make up only about 0.1% of the total US population, but has ended up owning well over 50% of all US mineral assets, worth well over $50 billion. How do these Gujaratis do it? The answer is dhando. Dhando is a Gujarati word that literally means business, but to them, it's not just a simple word, but a framework for investing in places to get high returns with very low risk. This framework is embedded deep in their veins. One of the most common jargons heard in investing is that the pathway to get high returns is to take high risks. Dhando investing is exactly opposite. Dhando is an approach to investing whose central concept is low risk, high returns instead of infamous high risk, high returns. It's all about to participate in the coin toss outcome where heads, I win and tails, I don't lose much. Let's see what we as value investors can learn from the Dhando framework. This is The Better Investor, helping you achieve your financial goals and freedom through organizing your finance, stock market investing and learning from billionaires. And these are top 5 lessons from the book, The Dhando Investor, written by Monish Pabrai. Lesson number 1. The Circle of Competence. We as human beings cannot know everything about everything, but we surely have fair amount of knowledge regarding few things. No one knows this better than Gujaratis. They only step foot in the business about which they have knowledge about. If a business opportunity knocks on their door that they do not understand, they give it a pass. There is no shame. Rahul Dravid, a veteran cricket batsman, has highest of the batting averages. Once asked how does he achieve it, his answer was, "The bowlers are really skillful. He really does not understand how can he strike every ball that is thrown at him by these highly skilled bowlers. Thus, he gives those balls a pass. But when, once in many times, a loose ball presents itself to him about which he is sure he can strike, that is the only time he strikes it." Even the world's greatest investor, Warren Buffett, says that he cannot understand 99% of the businesses. Without a doubt, that is the very first screen anyone in investing must have. If you cannot in simple language explain what is the product that company sells in order to make money, what are the utilities of the product, you have no business to dip your finger to even test the waters. Warren Buffett says that the size of your circle of competence is not so important, but knowing its boundaries are. The very first question you must ask yourself when someone presents you a business idea is, do I really understand how this business is run? If your answer is no, don't strain your head and walk ahead. Lesson number 2. Invest in copycats, then inventors. The first few Patels who figured out the wonderful motor ownership business economics in the United States were the trailblazers. The thousands upon thousands of Patels who simply copied the model did not innovate. They simply lifted a proven idea and scaled it. One of the most common things among 4 of these top 5 richest Indians is that of them, all of them are copycats and none of them the inventors. They improvised what was already a proven business and made their money on it. None of them owns a space station or has revolutionized the world with their innovation. All that they have done is cloning. Mukesh Ambani exploded his wealth because of Reliance Jio. When Jio came, there were already plenty of telecom giants in India who were successful. Jio just came in and made few tweaks in its attractive offerings. Adani, his main business is in construction of airports, water ports and infrastructure. Just when all the infrastructure companies were going through bankruptcies in India during the demonetization, Adani came in and scaled up his projects and construction bids. Uday Kotak, CEO of Kotak Mahindra Bank. Kotak Mahindra Bank was before a brokerage firm dealing in selling and buying shares. Seeing the initial success of HDFC Bank, ICICI Bank and Axis Bank, he thought he could do well in lending business. He stepped in and made it a bank in 2003. Mr. Radhakishan Damani started a brick and mortar retail chain called DMart when they were already successful ones of the likes of Big Bazaar, Pantaloons, Amartex in India. Even Ray Kroc, Loved the business model of the McDonald's brother hamburger restaurant in San Bernardino, California. Ray Kroc in 1954 bought the rights to the name and know-how and he scaled it with minimal change. Many of the subsequent changes or innovations did not come from within the company with its formidable resources. They came from street smart franchises and competitors and then scaled up to be included in national and international menus. The company was smart enough to adopt them just as they adopted the entire concept at the outset. Some of these important innovations include the Ronald McDonald clown was inspired and created by Washington DC franchisee in 1963. The Filet-O-Fish was developed by Cincinnati franchisee in 1963. The Big Mac was developed by Pittsburgh franchisee in 1968. The Egg McMuffin was developed by Santa Barbara franchisee in 1973. The drive-thru was first introduced by Arizona franchisee in 1975. Seeing its success scaled up. Even the Happy Meal was lifted from Burger King, its competitor, in 2001. As Monish says, innovation is crapshoot. But investing in a business that are simply good copycats and adopting innovations created elsewhere rules the world. Lesson number 3. Industries with rapid change are bad for investors. The big money in investing is made by holding companies in portfolio which perform better than average and that too for a very long period of time. Time is the most important factor when it comes to compounding money. A company may have reported supernormal profits, maybe due to one single event or one single phase of economy. But from an investment perspective, it is of no benefit to you if it cannot replicate the performance on a continuous basis. Thus, it is prudent that for a company to do better than average for a very long period of time, its inherent business must not change much. Warren Buffett says, "We see change as the enemy of investments, so we look for the absence of change. We don't like to lose money. We look for mundane products that everyone needs." From a judgment perspective, it is difficult to judge that what will be the business which are likely to last for next 50 years. But it is easier to judge what will not. It is highly likely that we are still going to eat rice, smoke cigarettes, drink coffee and coke 50 years from now, but very difficult to judge whether then we would still be using Facebook and watching Netflix. The real Dhando does not set his foot in such a place, since Dhando is all about investing only and only when odds are highly in your favor. Investing in a business which rapidly changes itself means stepping in a place where odds are already against you, which is not a Dhando way of investing. Lesson number 4. High risk versus high uncertainty. The market most of the times confuse risk with uncertainty. And as a dhando, you can benefit immensely from this confusion. The market participants hate uncertainty and it demonstrates that hate by collapsing the quoted stock price of the underlying business. Here are the likely reasons that are going to lead to a distressed stock price. High risk and low uncertainty, high risk and high uncertainty, and last, low risk and high uncertainty. The fourth logical combination, which is low risk and low uncertainty, is loved by the market participants, and stock prices of such companies are quoted at very expensive multiples in stock market. Monish says to avoid investing in such rosy businesses, which are priced to perfection. The dhando would want to avoid all the possible combination and solely focus on investing in one type, that is low risk and high uncertainty, which gives us most sought after coin toss odds, which are heads I win, tails I don't lose much. Such opportunities most of the times arrive in distressed times. For example, FSSAI, Food Regulating Authority of India, banned Maggi noodles in April of 2015 after its test found excessive lead in noodle samples. The company had to remove Maggi packs, all 35,000 tons of the product from store shelves, taking a hit of 450 crore from its profits. There was an uncertainty in the market as to how long was this going to continue. In real, only 20% of the revenue came from sale of noodles. Worst come worst, the noodles brand would shut and Nestle would take a hit of 20% on its revenues. But in a sane mind, it was easy to assume that even if the court banned the noodles a little longer and the accusations were true, They would just reduce the lead content and continue with the daily operation. In reality, the uncertainty as to how long this dispute is going to take to resolve and how long will it affect the profits of the company and such things led the market participants to exit and stock price to tank. In reality, there was no risk involved in this trade. Sooner or later, the Maggi would be back in shelf with the low lead noodles and things would go on normally. These are the situation that Dhando sees. In 2014, the telecom players in India were having a cutthroat competition before Reliance Jio stepped in with their revolutionary, extremely cheap internet plans. There was high uncertainty in the mind of Mukesh Ambani, the owner, if their operations would succeed and will people would be willing to switch to their telecom services. Worst come worst, Jio would lose all the money and be just like any other telecom company, having no growth in the revenues. Even considering that scenario, Reliance's most of the revenues were coming from petrochemical business and almost nothing from telecom. Even if telecom operations failed and went bust, Jio could go back and focus on the petrochem business, which was already profitable. Heads, Reliance wins. Tails, Reliance does not lose much. Lesson number 5. Few bets, better bets, bigger bets. Since the low risk, high uncertainty Dhando situations are very few and show up occasionally, this Monish says few bets. It is not a Dhando way of investing to be part of every party in the town. Only when such a situation shows up, he would stake his money. Rest of the time, Dhando would just be searching for them. Better bets means choosing only those bets which have a favorable outcome to you of heads I win and tails I don't lose much. Thus, it is prudent that when putting our money into these highly favorable outcome situation, we invest big amount of money. If we invest too little, then that would hardly move the needle. Investing is almost like gambling. There is hardly an opportunity where you have 100% chances of an outcome to happen. The chances of you losing can be as low as 10%, but these would always be there. Thus, a Dhando does not put every penny of his wealth depending on one outcome. Because of that unfortunate 10% happens, he would not survive. But a Dhando definitely put a sizable amount of capital when he finds such situation where the downside is very less as compared to the upside. More on this is in takeaway number 5 from my last video on concentrated investing, which you can check out. All the great Dhando investors and all the wealthiest people who created their fortune have done it because of a very few ultra successful investments. Warren Buffett made it through American Express and Coke. Rakesh Jhunjhunwala made it through Titan and Crisil. Bill Gates through Microsoft and Disney. Lakshmi Nivas Mittal through his operations in steel industry. Vijay Kedia through Atul Auto and Sudarshan Chemicals. These people would not have been where they are had they not capitalized big on the best of their ideas. Let's have a quick recap. The Dhando investor only invests in simple, well-understood businesses. That requirement alone eliminates 99% of possible investment opportunities. We must remain squarely in our circle of competence and not even be aware of all the noise outside the circle. Within the circle, read pertinent books, publications, company reports, industry periodicals, and so on. Copycats do not depend on one single outstanding idea to drive their business. They just go on to improvise an already well-established idea, product, and then scale it up. While inventions, when done right, give huge payoff to those who invest in them early, but the risk of completely going bust is very high, which is not where Dhando wants to invest. Dhando would invest in business that is good at copying and improvising an existing business than to put his money in copycats. Wealth creation involves consistent outperformance for a long period of time. For a business to do well for a very long, it must be an industry where the rate of change is very slow or not at all rather than rapid. Market most of the time confuses situation of high uncertainty as high risk and smashes the stock price of such businesses. This is the best time for Dhando to step in and benefit from the behavior of the market participants. Dhando would look for opportunities of low risk but high uncertainty. When an opportunity comes to where the coin toss odds in our investing are heads I win, tails I don't lose much, you must not invest a small amount which barely moves the needle for your wealth. but invest big amount. But treat this with caution. No investment opportunity has 100% chances of success rate. Thus, one can never put all its money in just one investment idea. The amount of money you invest in a business must be directly proportional to probability of its success. That's it, guys. If you liked the video, please like, share, and subscribe. You can check out my past video on concentrated investing, which is a good read. I will come again with a summary of another investing book soon. Until then, cheers, guys.